Hi, this is Stylianos from the TESSERACT Academy, and in this video, I'm going to be talking about the discipline of statistics, how it is different from machine learning, and why statistics is still relevant in the era of data science. So statistics is a branch of mathematics that started around the 18th century. It was the first attempt to systematically analyze data. So all the cornerstones of modern data analysis were created in the discipline of statistics. So things such as summary statistics, terms such as regression classification, significance testing, forecasting, they were all created by statisticians. Statistics as a discipline is quite different when compared to machine learning. And these differences are mainly due to historical reasons. So first of all, statistics usually deals with smaller samples, in contrast to machine learning, which likes more big data. However, this is now changing since big data becomes more and more relevant, so statisticians have started turning their attention towards it as well. The main difference between statistics and machine learning is that statistics tend to be much, much more stricter on model assumptions and development. So there's a huge conceptual gap between the two disciplines. Statistics was born in mathematics departments, and it's very important, according to a mathematician's way of thinking, to make sure that any assumptions you make are sound and correct. Whereas machine learning was created in computer science departments, and it follows more of an engineer's mentality. That is, make something work and you can ask questions later. Statistics is much better in terms of transparency and interpretability. So if this is what you're after, statistical models were created having that in mind. A few more things about the historical differences between statistics and machine learning. I already mentioned that statistics was born in the 18th century, and let's put ourselves in that position. So you're in the 18th century and data collection is very difficult. So that's one thing. You actually need to go there, ask people questions or run experiments. There's no internet. Secondly, solving a model requires days of work. So if any of you ever try to solve a linear regression model by hand, they realize that it's very, very time consuming. It's also very easy to make mistakes. So it was very important to do two things back then. The first one was to extract as much information as possible from small samples. A way to do that is to make many assumptions around the distribution that your sample follows. If these assumptions are actually true, then you can extract lots of information from your data. Your tests have more power. So that's very important. Secondly, they also want to make sure that when they would create a model and they would go through the equations, they wouldn't have to repeat the same work twice. On the other hand, machine learning was born in the 20th century in computer science departments, where it was easy to try out multiple approaches in a single day. And with lots of data sets lying around, it's very easy to say, you know what, I'm just going to try different things, see what works, what not, and then I'll come up with theory later. This is why machine learning is so good in its predictive capabilities, but because it takes more of an experimental approach to data analysis, it really suffers in terms of interpretability. There's some kind of war in academics between statisticians and machine learning people. Maybe you'll see this in the industry sometimes. It's mainly statisticians attacking machine learning for its lack of transparency and the lack of theory. These accusations are largely true. Machine learning models are not very transparent. Some of them are. There are also techniques to make machine learning models easier to interpret. Or another video and a blog post, I'm talking about interpretable machine learning, but also there's some theory behind some of the machine learning methods applied. But in general, this is not the prime focus of machine learning. The prime focus of machine learning is predictive power. I do not believe this kind of arguments are very constructive. In my opinion, both approaches, that of a statistician and that of a machine learning specialist, are tools, and we just need to find the best tool for our job. So this depends on whether you want interpretability or predictive power. So let's move on to talk a bit more about statistics. There are two branches of statistics. We have descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. So descriptive statistics is what most people believe statistics really is. It's what I call high school statistics, things such as collecting, organizing, summarizing, and presenting data. Inferential statistics is actually the fun part. It's about extracting information about the population from a small sample. And this is where things such as hypothesis testing, statistical modeling, they're parts of inferential statistics. This is where they were born. So in descriptive statistics, we have two sets of methods. We have numerical methods to summarize data and graphical means. So I'm sure that most of you must be familiar with these ways to summarize and interpret data. Things such as bar charts, pie charts, histograms, or things such as the mean, the median of the data, or the variance. All these are parts of summary statistics. So if you're using dashboards or reporting in your business, then I'm sure you're already using some descriptive statistics. Inferential statistics, on the other hand, are a very powerful idea. So inferential statistics are based on the idea that you can make inference about the properties of a population, let's say a specific parameter for a population, for example, the height of a population, the income of a population, etc., by using only a small sample. And we do this through the quantification of uncertainty, and this quantification of uncertainty takes place by applying probability distributions, which is a way for us to express and control uncertainty. Inferential statistics is a very complicated subject, so I'm not going to go into depth here in probability distributions and the like. However, this doesn't mean that we can't apply inferential statistics in our practice. We don't need to be experts to do that. This is what this video is about. So I'm going to follow on with an overview of what statistical modeling is about and hypothesis testing and when you can use them in your business. So what is hypothesis testing? This is another subject for which I'm sure some people are familiar out there. So a statistical hypothesis is an assumption about the population parameter, such as the height of men in the United Kingdom is around 180 centimeters, or the median income in some other country is, I don't know, $45,000. So this assumption may or may not be true. And a hypothesis test is a formal procedure that we're using in order to accept or reject the statistical hypothesis. In most cases, we care about differences between groups or the existence of effects. So some examples. Is there differences in salaries between genders? Or A-B testing. Now, I have two versions of my website. Which one attracts more visitors? Or in clinical trials, does a drug have an effect on the patients as compared to a control group? So this is where we use hypothesis testing. So what is statistical modeling? So statistical modeling is another tool in our toolbox, which I personally believe is more powerful than hypothesis testing. Many people are familiar with hypothesis testing, but not so much with statistical modeling. Even when in many situations, statistical modeling can be treated as a superset of hypothesis testing in some cases. And what I mean by that? So statistical modeling cares about the type of relationship between input and output variables. So, for example, you can assume there's an additive relationship. So, for example, the effects of age and gender and income aggregate in order to determine whether someone buys a product or what the demand for your product will be. We always make a probabilistic assumption behind this relationship. The most common assumption made by linear regression that the noise is normally distributed, but there are other models for other cases. For example, if we have a problem where the response consists of integers, then the Poisson positive integers, then the Poisson distribution can be a very good choice of a model. And the reason I like statistical modeling that much is that it can be more flexible in many cases. So as I mentioned, through hypothesis testing, we can understand the differences between two groups. But by using statistical modeling, we can also understand what drives groups to make particular decisions, for example. In a business setting, in domains such as retail and sales, this can be very, very powerful. So here are some common statistical models. Linear regression is the most famous model out there because it was the first one that was developed. It's very simple to use. It's very fast. However, linear regression cannot solve all problems. So linear regression makes some assumptions, such as your response variable, that is the variable which you're trying to study, the variable which you want to predict from a set of variables that we call covariates, or input variables, that is. It's a real number, and it also the error is normally distributed. However, in some cases, we face binary response variables. For example, will someone buy something or not? This is where logistic regression is useful. And also, as I mentioned earlier, there are other models which have been developed for cases where our error is not normally distributed or our response variable is not a real number. So, for example, Poisson regression is a good model for counts. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Beta regression is another model that's very useful when our variable is bounded on the interval between 0 and 1. And also we have more flexible modeling choices with models such as generalized additive models that can model nonlinear relationships, Bayesian regression, which lets us incorporate prior knowledge, or splines. Okay, splines is another nonlinear model. So all this might look very confusing, but this slide is here not to give you a full overview of these techniques, but rather to demonstrate the breadth of statistical techniques that we have out there. So if you care about understanding the relationship between a set of variables and an output variable, then some of these techniques could be very useful, and they could let you understand the kind of relationship that these variables have, the direction, is it positive or negative, and whether this relationship is also strong or not. So this is a general set of guidelines for using statistics in your business. So you should do a hypothesis test when the assumptions are being met. These are assumptions such as the underlying normality of the population in a t-test or homoscedasticity in ANOVA. Obviously, it is the job of a statistician to figure this out. A very trivial example is the average height of a population, for example, males in England, or income in a country, etc. So this is a very common scenario. However, in businesses, I believe that hypothesis tests are more useful for comparisons, A-B testing being the prime example. So anytime you have groups, you can have multiple, there are tests which can accommodate that, then a hypothesis test is a reasonable thing to do. However, I'm a big fan of trying to recast these questions in questions that can be answered through statistical models, because a hypothesis test can basically give you a yes or no answer, right? So there are differences between two groups, yes or no. A statistical model can tell you much more than that. It can tell you whether, for example, age is a more important factor driving sales than gender or than the area where someone is living. And also in a statistical model, we can study many variables simultaneously, and we can even study their interactions, right? Because age might work in a different way depending on where someone lives or depending on the gender, okay? So we can actually work out more complicated relationships, which allows us to extract more information from our data. In general, when you want to study the relationship between two variables, you're going for statistical modeling. Finally, it's also worth mentioning about forecasting, which is another domain in statistics that deals with the prediction of future values. However, that's a bit too vast and complicated to analyze it here. And also forecasting nowadays seems to be taking place a lot through machine learning methods, especially in domains such as finance, because machine learning is more powerful for prediction. And when we apply forecasting, we usually care about making a profit in the sense that we might be using forecasting techniques to predict the prices of stocks, etc. So we might not care so much about the drivers of price as about actually making a prediction, placing a bet, and making a profit off of that. So this was Stelios from the TESSERACT Academy. In this video, I provided a very brief overview of the discipline of statistics, why it's still relevant, and when to use it. Statistics can provide us with great tools to understand our data, which are very easy to interpret, in contrast to most of the tools provided with machine learning. Machine learning is amazing in terms of its predictive power, but when we care about understanding the factors that can drive a variable, be it sales, growth, or otherwise, then statistics as a discipline has provided us with the best tools out there. So I hope you found this video informative. This was Stelios from the TESSERACT Academy. Thank you, and I hope to see you in another round of our videos.